Hi, I'm Ted Bible, pastor at St. Mark's Methodist Church, and thank you for joining me once again today as we continue our walk through the Gospel of Mark. And as always, before we get started, I just want to once again invite you to share any prayer concerns with us, joys or concerns. You may email those requests to limastmarks@gmail.com, limastmarks@gmail.com, and we would be happy to be in prayer for you. Additionally, if you live in the Lima area and you do not have a church family, we would love for you to come and on a Sunday morning and be our guest. Our worship begins at 10:15, and we are located at 1110 North Metcalf Street here in Lima. Well, we are continuing with our journey through Mark, and we're going to be looking at the 14th chapter and studying today verses 12 through 31. So chapter 14 of Mark, beginning with verse 12. And Mark writes for us. He says, on the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover? So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house that he enters, the teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there. So the disciples left, went into the city, and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. The man carrying a jar of water was an unusual sight because women usually carried liquids in jars or in pitchers. And men normally carried liquids in animal skin containers. Therefore, a man carrying a jar was a distinctive sign to the disciples and to, and we are told in Luke's writing that these two disciples would have been Peter and John. And these gentlemen needed a distinctive sign because they were looking for a single man in a very crowded city. Now, fortunately, Jesus also told the two disciples that the man carrying the jar will meet them, and thus they will not need to roam around the city looking for him. And when the man, most likely a servant, met the disciples, they followed him to the house that he entered, and they said to the owner of the house exactly what Jesus told them to say. And to their amazement, and no doubt relief, the owner took Peter and John to a large furnished room, and there they made preparations for the Passover meal. This scene implies a few things. First, it implies that Jesus had followers in the city of Jerusalem, people who knew him and supported him, and who wanted to do what they could for him. Just as the unnamed owner of the colt made it available for Jesus to ride into the city on Palm Sunday, so now an unnamed man provides Jesus with a large room prepared for the celebration of the Passover. Second, what takes place here implies a certain level of secrecy. And Jesus had good reason to quietly make arrangements for the Passover. Jesus didn't want to be discovered and arrested by the Jewish religious leaders before it was time. And he didn't want Judas to betray him before he had the opportunity to give his final important talk to his disciples. Reading on then from verse 17. Mark writes that when the evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, Jesus said, I tell you the truth. One of you will betray me, one who is eating with me. Now they were saddened, and one by one they said to him, surely not I. And Jesus said, it is one of the 12, one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born. Jesus has said many things over the past 3 years that confused and surprised his disciples. But without a doubt, this was probably the most surprising thing that Jesus has ever said. After all, each of the 12 disciples believed that he was faithful and he was loyal to Jesus, and they believed that each of the other 12 disciples were also loyal to Jesus, and that they would be loyal to him unto death. In fact, in the 11th chapter of John, when Jesus told his disciples that they would be returning to Judea following the death of Lazarus, it was the disciple Thomas who said, "Let us all go with him, that we may die with him." At this point, none of the disciples suspected Judas, and the idea that one of them would choose to betray Jesus must have seemed absurd. When Jesus said that one of them would betray him, they were saddened. They were sorrowful, and no doubt they were greatly confused. So one by one, they asked Jesus, "Is it I? Am I the one who's going to betray you?" Jesus said, "It is one of the 12," meaning one of his disciples, "that it is will be the one who dips bread into the bowl with him." Now, all the disciples dipped bread with Jesus. So this phrase identified the betrayer as a friend. Mark doesn't tell us that it was Judas who will betray Jesus. We learn it is Judas when we read Matthew's account and John's account as well of the writing of this event. Now, in my study of this passage, I learned that in Middle Eastern culture, betraying a friend after eating a meal with him was then and still is today regarded as a worst kind of treachery and disrespect. Continuing on then in verse 22. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, and they all drank from it. "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "I tell you the truth, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus and his disciples ate the traditional Passover meal, which had a historical as well as symbolic meaning. The unleavened bread represented the bread that the Israelite slaves took with them during their exodus from Egypt. The bitter herbs recalled the bitterness of slavery in Egypt. The stewed fruit, which possessed the consistency and the color of clay, recalled the making of bricks that the Israelites made while they were slaves. The salt water was a reminder of the tears shed under Egypt's oppression. The main course of the meal, a freshly sacrificed lamb, did not symbolize anything connected to the agonies of Egypt, but rather it was the sin-bearing sacrifice that allowed God's judgment of death to pass over the household of believers, those who believed in the God of Abraham. During the meal, the participants drank four cups of wine. These four cups correspond to the four expressions of redemption used to describe the Exodus from Egypt, as written in the Old Testament book of Exodus and in chapter 6, in verses 6 through 7. These words were spoken to Moses from God, and I will review those here in just a moment. So Jesus and his disciples ate the meal. They sang psalms, they read scripture, and they prayed, as was the tradition. When the bread was lifted up at the Passover meal, the presider over the meal would say, and in this case it would have been Jesus, they would say, "This is the bread of affliction which our fathers ate in the land of Egypt. Let everyone who hungers come and eat. Let everyone who is needy come and eat the Passover meal." Jesus took two traditional parts of the Passover meal, the passing of the bread and the drinking of the wine, and he gave them new meaning as representations of his body and of his blood. He used the bread and the wine to explain the significance of what he was about to do for the people on the cross. Thus, Mark records for us the origin of the Lord's Supper, which we also know and refer to as Holy Communion or as the Eucharist. Once again, in verse 22, Jesus says, where we read that while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it. This is my body." To take and eat means that it won't be forced upon you. Jesus didn't force it upon anyone. But rather, you have to receive it, because eating is absolutely vital for life. Without food and without drink, we perish. Likewise, without taking Jesus into our innermost being, we will also perish. Verses 23 and 24, again they read, "Then he took the cup, he gave thanks, offered it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said, 'This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many.' And then when Jesus said, 'I tell you the truth, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God.'" When he said that, here is what he meant. Now, as I stated earlier, the Passover meal consisted of four cups of wine that correspond to the four expressions of redemption used to describe the Exodus from Egypt. Once again, it's recorded in the book of Exodus, chapter 6, verses 6 and 7. The first cup of wine meant, "I will bring you out. God will bring the people out of Egypt." The second cup of wine meant, "I will rid you of their bondage. They will no longer have bondage over you." And the third cup of wine meant, "I will redeem you. I will save you." Jesus and his disciples drank these three cups of wine. The fourth cup, they did not drink, because it meant, "I will take you for my people and I will be your God." Jesus said that he will drink that cup later at the feast in the future kingdom of God. Jesus is waiting for all of his people to be gathered to him. And then there will be a great supper, a great feast, which will include the drinking of the fourth cup of wine, the final cup of redemption. Then Jesus says in verse 27, After the disciples had gone to the Mount of Olives, he said, "You will all fall away. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.'" Notice that Jesus says that the disciples will all fall away. He doesn't say that they will stop believing in him, or that they will lose their faith in him, or that they will stop loving him. But rather, Jesus is saying that because of the relationship with him, because they know him, because they are his followers, because they are his disciples, they will soon be receiving pressure from others that will cause them to claim that they do not know him. They will make this claim because Jesus will choose to be crucified on a cross rather than fight back against those who are persecuting him. Jesus told his disciples this not to condemn them, but rather he wants them to be aware of the weakness that is associated with the human condition. And he said this to show them that he really was in command of the situation. And he also said this to demonstrate that the scriptures regarding the suffering of the Messiah must be fulfilled, and that they would in fact be fulfilled. From our study last week, we know that the devil had already prompted Judas to betray Jesus. But the other disciples were not aware of Judas's plan. In the Gospel of John, we are told that while the disciples were having their meal with Jesus, Jesus told Judas to go quickly and do what you need to do, which means Judas was to go and to betray Jesus. So Judas got up and he left the meal. And thus there are now 11 disciples present with Jesus on the Mount of Olives. Jesus knew what would eventually happen, and yet he went on with the plan. Jesus had repeatedly predicted his death and his resurrection, but his disciples are still unable to grasp how such a thing could possibly happen to Jesus, the Messiah, to whom they had been following and to whom they had devoted the last 3 years of their life. And then verse 28, Jesus says, "But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." Jesus has announced that what will be taking place in the very near future, and he is already looking beyond his death on the cross to his resurrection and to his meeting with the disciples once again in Galilee. In Matthew 28, we read that after his resurrection, Mary and Mary Magdalene went to the tomb, and there they met an angel of the Lord who told them that Jesus was not there, that he was gone, that he had risen from the dead, just as he said that he would do. The angel showed the two women the empty tomb and then told them to go and tell the disciples that Jesus has risen from the dead and that he would meet them. And that he would meet them where? The angel told them that he would meet them in Galilee. Concluding then, verses 29 through 31. Peter spoke up, and Peter said, "Even if all fall away, I will not." And to that statement, Jesus replies and says, "I tell you the truth. Today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times." But Peter insisted emphatically, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And all the other disciples, they said the same. Peter spoke up and he responded to Jesus, not being aware of both the spiritual reality and the spiritual battle that Jesus knew would soon be taking place among the disciples. Peter felt brave. Peter felt confident. And he had no thought or perception beyond that very moment. Soon, however, Peter would be intimidated, and he would become scared when he is confronted and challenged by a servant girl. And before her and those around her, Peter would deny that he ever knew Jesus, and he would deny him three times. Jesus knew Peter would fail in what he thought was his strong area, that was being bold and courageous. Through this solemn warning, Jesus gave Peter an opportunity to take heed and consider his own weakness. Jesus knew Peter far better than Peter knew himself. And despite Peter's intentions, Jesus had pointed out to him that he was soon going to take a significant fall. The rest of the disciples also overestimated their personal strength and commitment as well. And they too declared that they would die before disowning Jesus. And in just a few hours, they would all scatter. They would all run away. And they would leave Jesus alone with his accusers and with those who wish to do him harm. The takeaway I offer you from the sermon today is this. Jesus knew that his disciples were going to run for their lives, despite the fact that they all declared that they would die before disowning him. He knew that in the moment of his deepest need, that they would be gone. But Jesus does not condemn them. He tells them that he tells them that when that terrible time is past, that he will meet them again. Jesus knows our human weaknesses too. He knows how certain we are to make mistakes and how likely we are to fall and how we are to fail at times in our faith and in our loyalty to him. But that knowledge does not turn his love to bitterness or to contempt towards us. This passage also shows us something about Peter and teaches us something about ourselves as well. Peter's fault was his overconfidence in himself. He knew that he loved Jesus, and that was never in doubt. And he thought that all by himself he could face any situation which might arise. We are really no different than Peter. We too are confident that we can face almost any situation before us, and that we do not need to rely upon Jesus to walk with us through every challenge, through every trial, and even through every opportunity that we face in life. I'm reminded of a scene in the movie The Shack, when Mac walked on water with Jesus to get to the other side of the lake. And later, when Mac wanted to return back to the site from where he began, he tries to walk on the water again, but this time he fails. And Mac turns and he looks to Jesus, and Jesus says to him, "It always works better when we do this together, don't you think?" My friends, life is easier no matter what we are facing when we allow Jesus to go with us, when we don't shut him out, when we don't think that we can go it alone. We too often encourage people today with the statement, "You've got this." I honestly can't imagine Jesus ever saying that. But more likely what he would say is that we've got this. That is, we've got this if you allow me, Jesus, to come along with you. Let us pray. Dearest and most gracious God, make us once again mindful of your love poured out for us in all the world, that we may be brave and powerful witnesses for Jesus Christ in our homes and in our workplaces, in our schools, in our community, and throughout the world. This is our prayer today in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you for joining me today as we continue this walk through the Gospel of Mark. As always, we just want to say thank you for your prayer support as well as your financial support of the ministries here at St. Mark's. And if you would like to support us financially, you may do so by mailing your gift to St. Mark's Methodist Church, 1110 North Metcalf Street, Lima, Ohio, 45801. And so until next time, I pray God's blessing be upon you. And I pray that you won't go it alone, but that you will always invite Jesus to come alongside with you. Because it's always easier when he's alongside of you.